Well, we're calling this message, How Do We Get There? You might be asking yourself, get where? Well, if you were here a couple of weeks ago, I brought a message from, I use a scripture in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, 2, and 3, where I believe Paul is the author of the book of Hebrews. He said, let's not go over again the elementary principles of Christ, but let's go on to perfection. Yes. Not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and baptisms and laying on of hands. Repentance from dead works, faith toward God, baptisms, laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. There's six foundational doctrines. Let's not lay these again. He said, let's go on to perfection. And this we will do if God permits. What's implied in that passage is God wants us to have those foundational truths established in us to allow us to have the necessary foundation to go to full maturity. So we had brought a message a couple of weeks ago called Going On to Perfection. Now, for some, if you missed it, I want to encourage you to go back to our YouTube channel, Shekinah Worship TV, or go to our website and hear the message, because today's going to be part two of that. What does it mean? What does perfection mean? Well, I want to say this, that Jesus commanded that we become perfect. He taught that we should become perfect. The apostles taught it. Jesus prayed for it, that we would become perfect. The apostles taught and exhorted and prayed that we would become perfect. And the scripture tells us that when the Lord comes again, he's going to expect us to become perfect by the time he's here. Now, we gave a definition, a good working definition of what that means. What does perfect mean? I like what John Wesley said. He said, Christian perfection does not mean never making an error in judgment. To do that, we would have to be all-knowing like God, and only God is all-knowing. So Christian perfection does not mean we never make a mistake or an error, but Christian perfection is when every motion of the heart comes from love for God and love for my neighbor. How many know we can do that? Amen. See, when a person is walking in wholehearted devotion of love toward God and walking in love toward my neighbor, before God, he considers that a perfect Christian. Now, there's two kinds of perfection. I want to touch on this before we go on, because our message today is how do we get there? How do we get there? Now, there is the perfection of wholeheartedness. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, the eyes of the Lord search to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are perfect toward him. That's the King James. But in the Hebrew, the word means fully given to him. So in that context, perfection or a perfect heart before God is a heart that is wholehearted toward him. It's a heart that doesn't have distractions and other loves. It's a heart where he is our first love and we are wholeheartedly going after him. Now, you could take an immature Christian, a new believer. Maybe they've only been a Christian 1 year. They may not have some of the maturity that a Christian that's been a believer for 30 years has. But if they are wholehearted that God is their first love, even in their immaturity, God considers their heart perfect. If someone that's more seasoned, has more experience, we might consider them more mature, but their heart is not wholehearted. Lord's not first love, their heart's not perfect. So there's a perfection of having a wholeheartedness toward God. Throughout scriptures, it's very clear Jesus wants nothing to do with anything concerning lukewarmness. In fact, in his own words, it makes him want to vomit. Because God is worthy to be loved with all of our heart. He commands us to love him with all of our heart. He expects it because he loves us with all of his heart. And so wholeheartedness is one kind of perfection. We should all have that, and we could all have that right now. And if we don't have that, today's a good day to repent. If we have other loves, other distractions, Jesus is not first love. That means our heart is not perfect before God. Then there's the other perfection of, and I don't want to retell the whole thing, but I want people to understand there's a perfection of a farmer growing fruit. If you're growing citrus and you have a small green fruit on the tree, but if that's the time of year, that's the season of year, that's where that fruit is supposed to be at that time, that fruit is perfect. When it gets fuller and bigger and it's, maybe you're growing oranges, it's full size, but it's still not orange yet. But if that's the time and where it's supposed to be at that time, if you ask the farmer, he'd say, how's your fruit? He said, it's perfect. But if, when it's supposed to be ripe and fully orange and juicy and sweet, and it's small, hard, and green, it's not perfect. So there's a perfection of being on track with God. Like, I'm in the stage of development I'm supposed to be. I'm where I'm supposed to be, right? I'm not fully there yet, but God says you're perfect. Because you're wholehearted and you're going after Him with all everything in you, that means you're where you're supposed to be. We should all be perfect before God. And while our hearts are perfect before God, by the grace of God, God wants all of us to aim at perfection. While we have a perfect heart, to aim for perfection. And that means full maturity unto walking, abiding in Christ, manifesting Christ. Every believer is given the grace of God and the call of God to grow up into the full stature of Christ. So how do we get there? First of all, we need to understand that Jesus said at the end of the age is the harvest. He told us that in the parable of the wheat and the tares. He said a man had a field of wheat, but at night his enemy went out and sowed tares. They look like wheat, but they're not. They're like weeds. They take up ground and they produce no fruit. And his servant said, an enemy has sowed tares. Shall we go pull up the tares? He said, no, let them both grow up together until harvest time. If you take the tares out now, it will inhibit the growth of the wheat. You'll uproot some of the wheat. Now, let's pause right there. Jesus explained later what the parable meant. He said the field is the world. The wheat are the sons and daughters of the kingdom. And the tares are the sons and daughters of the devil. Now notice this. He said, don't take the tares out yet. They need to grow up together in order for the wheat to become fully mature. If you try to take the tares out now, it'll stop the maturity of the wheat because the wheat will be pulled up. Which means we need to be in this fallen world to become overcomers. You're not an overcomer unless you have something to overcome. And so, because we think sometimes victory means get the devil away from me. No, the victory is let me rise up so he has no place in me. Let me become a fully mature son or daughter of God. Here's spiritual warfare for you. Romans 16, verse 19 and 20. Be excellent in what is good and innocent in what is evil, and the God of peace will soon crush Satan's head under your feet. In other words, grow up and walk like we're supposed to walk, and God will crush the devil under your feet. Now, we don't hear that in spiritual warfare seminars. We hear about marches and blowing horns and flags and finding the names of demons and yelling at them. How about grow up? How about become excellent in what is good, innocent in what is evil, and then we can walk like Jesus walked. Jesus said, the prince, the ruler of this world's coming and he has nothing in me. So there's victory. Amen. How about this? Submit to God, resist the devil and he'll flee. But in spiritual warfare, we just focus on resist, resist, resist. What we ought to do, go back and become good at submitting to God. If we submit to God, the resist part goes easy. That's the way it is. So the tares are necessary for us to have something to overcome. Amen. And anyway, we're in that season now. He said, let the wheat and the tares grow up together, and then the harvest will come. What's God going to do? Jesus said, first, gather the tares in bundles and burn them. That's a judgment on the wicked. Jesus. That happens before the wheat comes in, which means we will be here. He didn't say gather the wheat. Let's all fly away, then burn up the tares. He didn't say that. Don't get mad at me. I'm telling what Jesus said. So, now we're at the end of the age. How many can see the tares? How many see tares are getting more mature? They're growing in wickedness, calling evil good and good evil. Yeah. So that means it's now time, and it's past time, for us to grow up, all the wheat to grow up. Amen. We're in the time of Isaiah 60, where darkness and gross darkness is covering the earth. It's time now. Now, it's not a passive thing. He said, for us, arise, shine. He didn't say wait for the light to fall on you. He said, rise up and shine. You rise, you shine. For your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. His glory will be seen upon you. There's a wheat and the tares. So now it's more important than ever that we understand our calling to become perfect. We're to become fully mature in Christ. We're to walk. When he comes, when the Lord comes to the earth, he wants to find a people that are without spot, holy, and blameless, walking in the glory of God. I'll show you that from Scripture. So we don't know that, if we don't know that's what God expects of us, if we think, well, I got saved and just go to church and pursue the American dream and pray that we all get out of here before anything bad happens. That's the perverted non-gospel that's being preached around the world. And so we're going to look just for a few minutes at some of the scriptures about it, and then we're going to see how do we get there. Ready? Yes. All right, Matthew 5:48. Jesus commanded perfection. He said, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. In context, when he said this, in the context of Matthew chapter 5, is in loving our enemies. He said, love your enemies. Pray for them that curse you. Do good to those. Bless them. Do good and pray for them that despitefully use you and curse you and hate you. So in that context of walking in love, Jesus said, you shall be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Jesus taught Christian perfection. Again, in Luke 6:40, he said, the disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfect will be like his teacher. Now, New King James says perfectly trained. The word trained is not in the original manuscript. So he's perfect means complete and whole. It means you finished the training course. You're lacking nothing. You've got all the components. So Jesus said, what does perfection mean? It means we'll be like our master. Now, Jesus not only commanded perfection, taught perfection, but he also prayed for it for us. In John chapter 17, verse 20, he said, I do not pray for these alone, but I pray for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. He doesn't mean, I don't believe that Jesus was primarily referring to they, meaning, all right, let's have a lunch and get some Methodists, some Catholics, some Baptists together and become one. Have a John 17 meeting. That's not what he meant. Jesus said, Father, I pray that they may be one as you and I are one. Yes. So how was Jesus and the Father one? Here's how. He gave up his will. Yes, sir. Lo, it is written in the volume of the book, I've come to do thy will, O God. Jesus said, I came down from heaven not to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing. He didn't even speak on his own. In the Gospel of John, he said, whoever speaks on his own is seeking his own glory. He said, as I hear, I judge. He said, I don't do the works. The Father in me does the works. The Father and I are one. He said, without him, I can do nothing. So he completely yielded himself to the will of the Father. The Father filled him with his Spirit, guided him, spoke to him, and empowered him so that he was the manifestation of the Father. At the end of his earthly life, in John chapter 17, verse 6, He said, Father, I manifested your name to the men you gave me. Name means character, nature. Philip came to Jesus and said, because he'd heard Jesus talking about the Father, he said, oh, Master, Lord, show us the Father, and that will make us, that's enough for us. And he said, Philip, you've been with me all this time. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. We're told in the book of Hebrews and also in Colossians that Jesus is the express image of the invisible God. So the oneness that Jesus and the Father had, he calls us into that to where we become one with God in the same exact way that Jesus and the Father are one. Amen. That's his prayer. That's called perfection. So in John, that's what perfection is, where it's no longer I who live, Galatians 2:20, but I live. I'm not living anymore, but I am, but it's not me, it's Christ in me, for I've been crucified. So he says in John 17, Father, that they are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. The world's going to believe when they see Christ in us. And the glory which you gave me, I've given them, that they may be one, just as we are, I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one. So perfection is Christ living and moving and manifesting in you and me.
Amen.
That's perfection. That's what we're called to. Now the apostles, Jesus taught perfection and he prayed for it. He just prayed, Father, I pray, make them one, Father, like you and I are one. So he taught it and then he prayed it. The apostles taught it and they prayed it. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, it says, he, the Lord, himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints. Now, if you have the King James, it says for the perfecting of the saints.
Amen.
And that's what the word is in the Greek. It means to be completely furnished, to be made whole, to be lacking no components, to finish the course, to be done, to equip or perfect, to furnish the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. So apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers should have as one of their primary ministry goals to building up believers so that they walk in Christian perfection.
Amen.
I know this is a shock to many people, but we can't be perfect. You haven't read the Bible. You haven't heard the gospel. We really haven't. Because the same grace that can forgive me of my sins can deliver me from them.
Amen.
Watch. They're given to perfect the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. Verse 13, tell we all, everyone say we all.
We all.
Sounds like Texas, so. Tell we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. How perfect? To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So God said the fivefold ministry gifts are given to equip the saints until all the saints become like Jesus. How much like Jesus? To the measure of the stature of the fullness. I know how some are thinking, I'm too weak. I can't do that. You don't know the weakness I have. You don't know the grace of God.
Amen.
You don't know the ability of God to transform us.
Yes.
You don't know the promises of God to bring it to pass.
Yes.
But hopefully you will by the end of this message at least know some of it. So the apostles taught it. Now, why are we focusing on this? Because now is the time for the body of Christ to rise up out of carnal Christianity and walk in the Spirit as one with Jesus.
Amen.
The world is not going to believe until they see some people who have become one like Jesus and the Father are one. That's what Jesus said. He said, Father, make them one like we are, then the world will believe. They're not going to believe our programs. They're not going to believe our singing, our preaching, whatever else we do. The fog, the smoke, they don't care. But when they see people walking like Jesus, that's it. Now watch, Colossians 1, 28 and 29. Paul is now saying, him we preach. There's not enough preaching of him. Him we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Watch this. To this end I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. So there was a supernatural energy and power working in the apostle to labor to this end, unto this goal. Where is that in the body of Christ today? Where are the apostles that have the anointing and the power of God laboring unto this end to bring every man perfect in Christ?
Amen.
See, that's the apostolic burden. We see that 2 Corinthians 7, verse 1, it says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. So holiness is to be perfected, brought to full maturity. He said, having these promises, what promises is he talking about? God gave awesome promises and said, now, in light of these promises, let's perfect holiness.
Amen.
In the fear of God. We need the fear of God to become perfect.
Yes.
Without the fear of God, you can't work out your salvation. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure.
Amen.
The working out of your salvation doesn't mean work to pay for your sins to get forgiven. Our sins are paid for by the blood of Jesus on the cross. It means the transformation into the image of Jesus.
Amen.
That's the working out of the of our salvation. And we're to work it out. And he said, if we'll work it out, he'll work it in.
Amen.
Because he works in us both to, watch, both to will and to do.
Yes.
We need to believe that.
Yes, Lord.
How are we going to get there? God's going to work in us both to will and to do. But we have to work it out. We have to do our part. So today we're going to find out what is the work we need to do.
Amen.
And if we'll work it out, he'll work it in.
Yes, Lord.
And we better get this, because having just believing doctrines won't make us overcomers. We have to walk it out. So he said, having these promises, let's perfect holiness in the fear of God. What were the promises? He said, I will be your God. You will be my people. I'll dwell in you and I'll walk among you. That's what he's saying. Now he's saying this to people who are already born again. The Spirit of Christ is in them already. But corporately, he's not dwelling in their midst and walking among them. So he's telling the believers, I will dwell in you and walk among you.
Thank you, Lord.
Therefore, come out from among them. Be separate.
Yes.
Touch not the unclean. Don't watch that thing on your device. Don't watch it. Don't listen to that person that's gossiping.
Come on.
Do not touch it. Come out. Be separate. That's what he said. Come out. Be separate. Do not touch it.
Yes.
Don't look at it. Don't listen to it. And then God said, I'll receive you.
Yes, Lord.
And I'll be your God. You'll be my sons and daughters.
Amen.
He said, so that's the promise. Come out. Be separate. Touch not. He said, I'll receive you.
Yes.
You'll be my sons and daughters. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let's perfect holiness in the fear of God. That it means. So it means perfect. Perfect holiness means perfect holiness.
Yes, Lord.
Now, so the apostles taught it. They taught that we should become perfect. Jesus taught that we should become perfect. Jesus prayed that we would become perfect. And the apostles prayed that we would become perfect. 1 Thessalonians 3, verse 12 and 13. Here's Paul praying. Now may the Lord make you increase and abound in love to one another and to all, just as we do to you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. How many know that if you're blameless in holiness, you're perfect?
Amen.
So how does that happen? It's always in love. The more we grow in love, the more we grow in Christian perfection. Loving God, loving each other. They prayed for it, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 9. The apostle says, I'm quoting, we pray that you will become perfect. 2 Corinthians 13, 11, finally, brethren, farewell, become perfect. Now, the thing about this, when we need to recover the apostolic gospel.
Amen.
When if God calls us to that, then he has to give us the grace to get there.
Yes.
And he did. He gave us the means. All things that pertain to life and godliness have been given to us through the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So, Peter tells us that at the end of the age, when the Lord comes as a thief in the night and the earth is burned up. By the way, if you read 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter tells us what it means of the Lord coming as a thief in the night. There's popular books and movies about the Lord coming as a thief in the night. And it's going to be some secret rapture. But if you read the Bible, that's not at all what the Bible says. It said, when the Lord comes as a thief in the night, the earth is going to burn up with fire. And he's going to bring judgment on the wicked. That's the coming of the thief. What it means is if you're not ready and you're not in Christ, you're going to suffer loss.
Jesus.
So it's not a secret coming. Coming as a thief in the night is not a secret coming. And the blessed hope is not a secret coming. Read the Bible. It says a blessed hope and glorious appearing. It's a glorious appearing. Anyway, that's for another message. If you want to go deeper into that, there's an excellent book on the subject by Dr. Michael Brown called Not Afraid of the Antichrist. Get that book and study it. It'll help. So here's what 2 Peter says. At the end of the age when everything's going to burn up, he said, we should be diligent to be found in peace without spot and blameless when the Lord comes. In peace without spot and blameless. John the Beloved, 1 John 2:28 said, Beloved, abide in him so that when he appears, we will have confidence and not shrink back with shame. Again, 1 Thessalonians 3:12 and 13 said, God will make you increase and abound in love so that you can be blameless in holiness at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the scriptures that talk about the second coming are always referring to us when he comes being found. God said, my bride's ready. They're without spot, they're holy, and they're blameless. I'm ready.
Amen.
See, it's not what we've been taught for decades. Nobody can be perfect. God knows that you're carnal, but you're just justified by faith. Of course you're justified by faith. That's how the thief on the cross got into heaven. That's how we all got justified. But our fulfilled righteousness has to catch up with our legal righteousness.
Amen.
Otherwise, we wouldn't be told over and over in the epistles, pursue love, pursue holiness, pursue it, go after it. You can't just stand on your legal righteousness and think you're going to be counted clean by God when he gets here. You'd be in for a rude awakening. Amen. So that was my introduction to answer the question, how do we get there? Anybody want to know? All right. Well, it's not a mystery. It's all in the Bible. If you have your Bible, you can follow along in Luke chapter 14, verse 25. Great multitudes went with Jesus, and he turned and said to them. Now, he knew how to thin out the crowds. He did. Great multitudes. We would say, okay, the great multitudes, hear what we do today. We'd turn around the multitudes and say, can everybody raise your hands up like this right now? We're going to get a picture. Going to go in our ministry magazine to all our partners. That's how we do it today. I think Jesus thought, there's too many people following me right now. They must not have got the message. I'm going to make it a little more clear for them. Now, great multitudes went after him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. He's not telling us to hate them. It means in comparison to our love for God, they should be on a lower level.
Yes.
The Lord has to be first love. We cannot make an idol out of our family. We're to love them. I have a responsibility to love my family, provide for them, take care of them. But I'm not to put them above love for God. That's what he means. This is not a scripture to give you a license to be a flake with your family. It means love your spouse, love your children, love your family, but never let them come before your love for God. That's what he's saying. Now watch. If you don't hate your father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters, yes, your own life, you cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he's laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all who see it begin to mock him. So he's saying, first of all, you have to count the cost. If you're going to become a disciple, if I'm going to be a disciple, if I'm going to go on to full maturity, I have to count the cost. Say, okay, I'm going to build a tower. Do I have the money to buy all the material? If you don't, then you better not start the project. Wait till you can pay the price. Because if you start the project and you find out in the middle, hey, I'm not really willing to surrender everything to Christ, you're not going to be his disciple. So right from the start, and he tells us what the price is. You have to hate your own life. Hate your own life means you don't love your life more than the will of God. When the self life says, hey, this is what I want, you say, wait a second, I've been bought by the blood of Jesus. I'm no longer my own. He died and rose again for us so that we who live should no longer live for ourselves, but live for him who died and rose again. So I might have that desire, but I say, Lord, I'm yours. What's your will? That's what he means. If we haven't counted the cost and said, my life is no longer mine. I belong to him. Yes. He calls the shots. He tells me where I live, what I do, who I marry. Right. He's my boss. Yes. So if we don't have that right up front, you can't be his disciple. Because what will happen is you'll start and not be able to finish.
That's right.
Watchman Nee said this, and I wholeheartedly agree with him. I need a little bit more sleep. Wholeheartedly agree with him. Wholeheartedly. Has that ever happened to anybody else? That's why God made black tea. I don't know if that's why. Lord, forgive me if I... Where was I? Help me. Watchman Nee said this. Every failure in the Christian life can be traced to this one thing. Failure to deny self. So we're going to be a disciple. We have to start with this. Hey, am I willing to deny myself? Am I willing to give up my dreams, my goals, my desire, my will, my wish? Deny it. And say, Lord, I trust you more than me. I trust your will more than mine. I trust you love me more than I do. I trust your wisdom. I surrender. Lead me. Use me, spend me, any way you want.
Yes, Lord.
I'll follow the Lamb wherever he goes. That's a disciple.
Amen.
So if someone has not got to that place yet, here's what Jesus said. I'm not saying it. Jesus did. He said, you can't be my disciple. We can't be a disciple until we first come and say, I surrender all.
That's right.
Well, let's read a little bit more. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he's laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. We see it all over the news. Every now and then, oh, this minister fell. This Christian did that. This one left the faith. That music artist did this. What happened? What happened? We didn't count the cost. We go part way. And we say, oh, here's where I can't go any farther. Self gets its way. And then everybody mocks. They said, oh, look at that. They said they were a believer.
Yeah, come on.
So he said, now, What king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he's able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation to ask conditions of peace. So if you have 10,000 warriors, your enemy has 20,000, you say, let's see, what do I want? Do I want all 10,000 of us to be dead? Or should we make peace? Let's send a delegate and try to work out some peace here. So God's saying, you still think you can do your own thing and survive? Why don't you come to the Lord and say, Lord, I surrender. That's what he's saying. So likewise, every one of you who does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Now, this is hard for some people to hear because they never heard it before. Or if they did, but it's in the Bible. But it's not preached very often because it doesn't build big ministries. But here's the good news is every ministry, God's going to put the fire to every ministry. He's going to test everybody's work to see whether it's wood, hay, and stubble or gold and precious stones and silver. So unless we build right, if we don't build this way properly, the fire's going to come anyway and reveal everything. So you might as well just do it the right way so when the fire comes, all the hay won't burn up. Now, so number one, how do we get there? Number one, ask the Lord, am I ready to sell all, pay all, surrender? Am I surrendered? Yes. And if you're not, that's the number one thing you need to work at, is keep going on. Go before the Lord and say, Lord, bring me to the place where I surrender all.
Yes, Lord.
Bring me to the place where I surrender all. Not my will, but thine be done. Now that's, you say, this is pretty deep. This is for mature Christians. No, it's Christianity 101. It's for the brand new believers. In fact, Jesus taught it to the inquirers that weren't even Christians yet. Just people who come and ask questions. He said, well, if you want to know, you got to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Okay, so number one, full surrender. But I'll tell you what, whoever tries to keep his life will lose it. Whoever will lose it for the Lord and his sake will find it and keep it for eternal life. It's the best deal we could ever make. Yes. The best deal we could ever make is say, Lord, I surrender all. You'll never, no one will ever stand before the Lord on judgment day and say, oh, I wished I hadn't have surrendered all the way to the Lord. But on judgment day, so many people will be gnashing their teeth and weeping and saying, oh my God, why did I hold on to all my idols? Why was I so selfish? Why was I so lazy? Oh Lord, how come I didn't pay attention to your word? Oh my God. There's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth among Christians. Why didn't I surrender all? Because one of the things God's going to show us when we go before judgment seat, he's going to show us what our life would have been had we surrendered all. He is. So number one, full surrender. It's the best thing we could ever do. Let's pray right now. Let's pray right now. Lord, I ask if we're not, we ask for the grace to bring our hearts to full surrender. Lord, if there's things that we are holding on to, that they're going to be a detriment on judgment day. God, it's going to be a weight. It's going to be something we wish we let go of. Lord, we're asking you for the grace now. God, we're asking you for the illumination. We're asking for the purifying fire of your Holy Spirit now. Deliver our hearts from holding on, Lord, to anything except your perfect will. Lord, your will is the best thing that could ever happen to us. We want your will, not our will. Amen. Now, the next thing, that's the first place, how to get there. We have three more. We just did one, full surrender. Number two, now if you say, I don't know if I'm there yet. So now we know that's what we target in prayer. That's what we go to in our relationship with God. Come to the Lord as you are. Isaiah 45, 22. God says, look unto me, all ye ends of the earth, and be saved. Philippians 2 says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. How do you do it? With prayer and with the word. But watch, God is the one that works in you both to will and to do. So if you're saying, I don't think I can surrender, guess what? God can change your heart. God can change our mind. He could say, if you're at a place, say, I can't surrender, go to the Lord and say, Lord, I can't surrender, but I want to. Lord, I can't give this up, but I want to. And then claim Philippians 2:13. Lord, work in me, Lord, to will and to do of your good pleasure, because I know your will is way better than what I want.
Amen. Amen.
And do that, and if you'll stay on that, just tenaciously stay on it, say, Lord, I'm not going to quit until you change my heart. God will do it. And he'll bring you to a place of freedom and joy. And you'll say, oh my God, I feel so good. Why? Because I gave up. Take out the white flag and surrender right now. I surrender all to thee I owe, all to thee my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All right, number two, how do we become perfect? We have to use the means of grace. What is that? What am I saying when I say the means of grace? Well, means means the tool or the thing God gives us to get there. The provision, the means. For example, you say, I'm going to go to Walmart. Well, by what means? You go out, well, I'm going on my bicycle. That's the means to get there. Or I'm going to take my Jaguar XKE. You say, that's the means you're getting there. So they do make a 12-cylinder Jaguar, don't they, Memo? I know Memo knows good cars. Those. Anyway, the way we get there is the means. So God has given all of us, everybody hear this, no matter how weak we are, our heart might feel, oh, Lord, I'm struggling. God knows that. He knows how to get us from a compromised heart to wholeheartedness. That's part of our salvation. That's the grace of God that brings us there. But we have to say, Lord, do it to me. And we have to stay on it in faith until it's done. So the means, now we said, Lord, number one, I surrender all. Number two, the means is by the washing of the water of the Word. The Word is the means of sanctification. That's how we're changed. Ephesians 5, verse 25. Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the Word. Now here's what the Word does, that he might present her to himself a glorious church. The washing of the Word, the renewing of our mind, the sanctifying that comes from reading the Bible, meditating on the Bible, believing the Bible, practicing the Bible, praying the Bible, the transformation makes us glorious.
Amen.
It does. It said he might present her to himself a glorious church. How glorious? Not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. How can that ever happen? By the washing of water of the Word. It's too quiet in here.
Amen.
Now listen, that means we read the Word. If we're not people of reading the Word, we're stunting severely our possibility of transformation. The Word is a means that God uses to renew our minds, to convict us of sin, to change our hearts, to wash us, to cleanse us. He uses the living Word. In John 6, verse 63, Jesus said, my words are spirit and they're life. This Word, when we read it, becomes alive.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 4 says it's living and powerful.
Thank
you, Lord. Psalm 119, verse 130 says, the entrance of his Word brings light and revelation and understanding.
Amen.
That's what it says. John 17, 17, Jesus said, Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. It's living. 1 Thessalonians 2, 13 says the word works effectively in us. Peter calls the word the incorruptible seed of God. Seed brings forth after its kind. It's a living word. Amen. So when we read the word, if we don't read the Word, we're preventing God from using the means to transform us. So we need to be people of the Word. Read the Bible. Read it. And then in other times, meditate on it. Read it and ponder it. Think about it. Then take the word and pray it back to God.
Amen.
That's a prayer that cannot be denied.
Amen.
Then apply the word to your walk. Hebrews 5:9. Jesus became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him.
Amen. Amen.
You can't obey him if you don't know his word. But when you walk in his word, his power comes.
Yes.
Ecclesiastes said, where the word of a king is, there's power. When you believe the word, there's power. When you apply the word, there's power. When you walk in the word, there's power. Where the word of a king is, there's power. His power to cleanse, power to renew, power to make us free from spots and wrinkles, power to make us glorious. The entrance of his word brings light. We have to eat the word. The word of God will bring the fire of God into your bones. Jeremiah said, I found his words and I ate them, and they were the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. He said his word was like fire shut up in my bones. And if you want fire in your soul, read the Bible. If you want fire in your soul, read it and pray it back to God. I was given a prophetic dream, and I was called by God through more than one dream, prophetic dream, to help equip the bride for the second coming of Jesus. He's coming again. Jesus is coming again. He's literally coming to this earth, and he's going to come for a bride that's made herself ready. And I was shown in a prophetic dream how the bride would be made ready. And one of the primary ways is she's going to read the Bible, meditate on the Bible, and pray the Bible back to God. And God's going to answer that prayer and transform her and make her glorious without spot or wrinkle. We need to be in the Word of God. He said the same way that Christ was born in Mary is how Christ is going to be formed in the end days, the last days, overcoming bride of Christ.
Jesus.
How did it happen? Jesus. The angel came to Mary and brought the word of the Lord. He said, you're going to give birth to the Son of God. She said, how will this be? She wasn't doubting. She believed. She was only asking how. And the angel brought the word of God. He said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and he will overshadow you.
Yes, Lord.
In other words, it's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And so Mary believed the word. Mary believed the word. And Mary prayed the word back to God. She said, be it done unto me according to thy word. And Christ was born in her.
Amen.
And that's what this apostolic prayer manual is about. If you're watching this, you can go to our website and download one for free. Apostolic, it's taking the word of God. We made 8 or 9 chapters. Every chapter is something that God desires of us. Every chapter is something that God wants back from the church.
Amen.
He gave himself for us so he could get a bride.
Yes, he did.
The first chapter, first love. Believe it and pray it back to God. Say, if he's not our first love, stay on it and pray. God, I want you to be first love in my life.
Yes.
And when we believe the word and pray it back, like Mary, that will be born in us.
Yes.
Next chapter, walking worthy. Take the word, pray it back to God. Say, Lord, I don't think I'm walking worthy, but I want to.
Yes.
Pray it back to God, and God will make it happen in us.
Yes.
See, Lord, I'm not fulfilling the Great Commission, but I want to. Take the word, pray it back to God. God will do it.
Yes, yes, Lord.
So the first thing, the means that we have to use, we have to be people of the word. Read the word, believe the word, pray the word.
Amen.
And then say, Lord, help me to walk in it.
Yes, oh God.
There's something supernatural happens. It's not just any word. This word is alive.
Amen.
It is alive. So that's the first thing is the word.
Amen.
Now the second thing, the word will make us perfect. It'll make us glorious. It'll get rid of all the spots, the wrinkles, and the blemishes.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
No bride wants to get married with pimples. Right? You don't want a boil on your face and pimples on your forehead. She wants to have all the blemishes gone. And that's what the word does.
Yes.
It gets all of us. She doesn't want to get married with her dress soiled.
No.
Looking like her husband's pants that he just finished working on the car. You don't want to go down the wedding, walk down the aisle like that. You want a spotless bride.
Amen.
You want to have no blemishes.
Amen.
You want to be beautiful in the beauty of holiness. When the King of Kings looks at you,
yes.
You want to say, that's my God. I've been washed in the water of the Word.
Hallelujah.
We need to get ready for the second coming of Jesus Christ. He's coming again. It's time for the bride to get ready. It's time to be serious and watchful. It really is. Now, the second means of grace is prayer. And it's connected to the first one. That's why I love praying this apostolic prayer manual. You can pray it every Friday when you come, every Friday at prayer. Every Sunday morning at 9 when you come here for prayer. All of you, you can pray it. But you can also pray it Monday through the whole week. Take the prayer manual. At different times, use it as part of your devotional life. Open it up to a chapter and just take the word and sincerely pray. And your heart will become tender. The Word and the Spirit will tenderize your heart. And you can just say, oh God, I want to be one of those people who has the garment ready for the King. Lord, I want you to be first love. Pray it back to God. But here's what it is. Prayer is how we access grace. Look at this. Colossians 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, he greets you. He's always laboring fervently for you in prayers that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. That's so awesome. How many would like to be able to stand before God and God say to you, you are perfect and complete in all my will? How is that going to happen? Somebody's going to labor fervently in prayer.
Amen.
See, Epaphras said he's always laboring fervently in prayer so that they, the church, could be perfect. That means lacking nothing, mature, complete in all the will of God. That's why I'm laboring in prayer. Now, you might think that my primary job in the church is to preach. It's not. My primary ministry is intercessory prayer for you.
Amen.
I pray 10 times more or more than that, maybe 20 than I preach. My primary calling is an intercessor. That's what I do. Above all, my primary thing is I take the word and I spend time praying. Oh God, pour out the spirit of wisdom and revelation on this church. Open the eyes of our heart. Flood us with revelation. Make your word alive. Let the entrance of your word bring light. Oh God, raise up an end time bride. Let them be holy. Let them be pure. Let them be knit together. Make them a house of prayer. Lord, make your church awake so they want to fulfill the Great Commission. That's my job. That's what the apostles did. They said, the apostles said, we're praying night and day exceedingly for you. We always pray for you. We pray without ceasing. So prayer, here's what Hebrews tells us, chapter 4. Come boldly to the throne of grace, and you'll find mercy and grace to help in time of need.
Amen.
That's what prayer is. Throne of grace is as far away as your breath. Oh God, help me in the name of Jesus. That's the throne of grace. So prayer is the means. If we don't pray, James, the brother of the Lord, said, we have not because we ask not. So we have to take the promises of God and pray them back to God. We have to labor fervently in prayer, personally and corporately, so we will become perfect in all the will of God.
Yes.
It's too quiet in here.
Amen.
Somebody help me.
Amen.
We need to labor fervently in prayer. Pray in the morning. Pray in the evening. Pray in the shower. Pray in the kitchen. Pray in your car.
Yes.
Most of all, have a dedicated alone prayer time every morning before you start the day. Pray. We must become people of prayer. Prayer, by prayer, we go to the throne of grace. Don't just keep struggling along in your own flesh.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, I'm having so much trouble. You know, my marriage is bad or this is bad. Don't just keep doing that. Get on your knees and say, God, help me. God, deliver me. Find scriptures that will fit your situation. Pray them back to God. John the Beloved said, if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if he hears us, we have the thing that we asked. One of my favorite prayers, I have a lot of favorite prayers. You know that whole prayer manual? Every prayer in there is my favorite. But I'll tell you one of my favorite is 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. It says, now may the Lord direct your heart into the love of God and the patience of Christ. You know, there's times we just don't know what to do. Lord, I'm having a struggle right now. What do I do? Here's my prayer. Lord, direct my heart into the love of God. Show me what love would do right now. And when we pray that prayer, God will lift our feet out of the miry clay of our dumb, carnal, stupid selfishness. He'll lift us up into the Spirit and he'll make us see with eyes of love. And he'll direct our heart into the love of God and the patience of Christ.
Amen.
Listen, we have not because we ask not. God's going to have some mature people at the end of the age. So prayer's the next one. Now, I could go on for weeks about prayer, but I'm not going to right now. That's two means of grace, the word and prayer. If we're not people of prayer, we're not going to become people that become perfect. He's always laboring fervently in prayer so that you can become perfect and complete. Pray about everything. God is a good God. He's going to answer your prayers. If you pray, Lord, sanctify me, he's going to answer that. You say, Lord, deliver me from this lust. Deliver me from this anger. Deliver me from that. Make me pure. Make me holy. Stay on it. Stay on it. You may be assailed with doubts and temptations. It may last for days or weeks. Stay on it. Just believe. Say, God, deliver me. I'm standing, Lord. I'm believing your promise. Make me free. Make me holy. He will. I said he will. And the third one. Well, the first one is I surrender all. The second one is the word. The third one is prayer. And the fourth thing that we need to become perfect. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
This is going to be your favorite. Patience. See, once Mary received, she prayed, she received the word. She couldn't make the baby come in a month. She couldn't make the baby come in 3 months. She couldn't make anything happen. She had to be patient. Practically every sin that we do as Christians can somehow be traced back to impatience. Selfishness, ambition, irritation, frustration, anger, greed. It's all somehow connected to impatience. Patience is a foundation for every virtue. Let me read a verse for you. James 1, verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking nothing. So now he said, first of all, the word makes us glorious, holy, without spot or wrinkle. The word makes us perfect. Prayer makes us stand complete and perfect in all the will of God. Prayer makes us perfect. And now patience makes us perfect. And when you put those three together, believe the word, pray the word, act on the word, walk in the word, and be patient. If you have all those working in your life, you're on the path to perfection. You'll become God. If we will do our, that's called working out our salvation with fear and trembling. If we'll work out, we'll work it out, God will work it in. He says, let patience have its perfect work. Now, how does patience happen? If you read Romans chapter 5, it says, tribulation works patience.
Yes.
And patience creates hope. And hope doesn't leave us ashamed because God pours out his Holy Spirit in our heart. Now, what does patience do? Patience is the foundation for every other virtue. If you can be patient, you won't fornicate. You wait till you're married. You can be patient, you won't get angry and frustrated. If you can get patient, you won't have selfish ambition to make your ministry come to pass. If you can do patient, you can move in all the virtues. All the virtue, the foundation you've got to have. If you lose patience, you lose all the other virtues. So he said, let patience have its perfect work so that you can become perfect. So remember, the goal of the commandment, 1 Timothy 1:5, is love. When we're on judged on judgment day, we're going to be judged by our love for God and our love for people. 1 John 4:17, love is brought to full maturity in us. It's brought to perfection so that we can have boldness on the day of judgment. James says the royal law is to love your neighbor as yourself. So live and so do as those who are going to be judged by this law. We're going to be judged by love. God's going to look into our heart. He's going to see every motive in every of our heart. Did we really do it for the love of God and for love of our neighbor? And if we did, we're going to have a good experience. But love, the first thing Paul writes to describe love, he said, love is patient. So patience increases our capacity for walking in love, and love is where perfection is. So he said, let patience have its perfect work. Every strife, every contention, all of it comes from impatience. To be patient, you have to have faith in God. Now he said, here's another verse, a companion verse that goes with that concerning being made perfect. Watch this. Now may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. So he's saying God is going, the God of all grace, everyone say the God of all grace.
God of all grace.
Who called you?
Who called?
I'm going to tell you who called you. The God of all grace called you.
Yes.
That should be encouraging. The God of all grace. What did God call you to? His glory. He called you to walk in the glory. How's he going to get you there? After you suffer a while, he's going to perfect you. Now, what's this suffering a while? What's that? It's called patience. Let patience have its perfect work. You say, I want to be a wheat. I want to be fully mature. Then let patience have its perfect work.
Amen.
Don't fight patience. Don't buck against it. Let patience win.
Yes.
And if we let patience have its perfect work, we will be made perfect. And as God increases our ability to walk in patience, it says in Romans 5, he then pours the love of God into our heart, and that's the glory of God. Let patience have. Now, practically, how do we do this? When you're in that situation, Brother Sandpaper comes along. Sister Sandpaper rubs you the wrong way. A situation happens. You can feel it rising in you. Ah! What do we do? Let patience win. We have to yield. We have to let patience. Now he said, after you suffered a while, all of us go through trials. None of us really knows what everybody's going through. Nobody's walked in other people's shoes. That's why in the last day to the overcomer, Jesus is going to give them a new name written on a stone. Name means character and nature. And he said, nobody knows what that name is except the Lord. That person. That means nobody knows what suffering that person walked through except God and you. And the suffering that you go through is the process God does to establish character in you. And that's the glory of the next age. The glory of God is his character. Listen to me just for a moment. The glory of God is his character. Moses said, Lord, show me your glory. He said, I'll pass by you and show you my goodness. And when he did, he proclaimed his name, which is his character. The Lord, slow to anger, full of compassion, long-suffering, merciful, but by no means clearing the unrepentant.
Jesus.
That's his character. His character is his glory.
Right.
What we go through in this earth, the trials that we go through, and we let patience have its perfect work. Then to that degree, we become conformed to his character, and that's our glory. That's why Paul said this light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us an exceedingly great and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things that are seen, for the things that are seen are temporary, but we look at the things that are eternal. So patience and, you know, the suffering, the God of all grace who called us to his glory, after you suffered a while, he'll perfect you. So that suffering that we go through is the trial we're in. When we're in trial, and we all go through fiery trials, when we go through them, the thing we all want is, I want this to be over yesterday. Right? And the nature of the trial is somehow it seems to go on longer. Have you ever been like me in a trial? And I'm like, Lord, I know for sure that if this trial continues for one more month, I won't be alive. And 2 years later, you're still alive and you're still in it. And I go, Lord, I don't even know how I'm alive. Anybody been there? What's happening? Let patience have its way. Why? What is God doing? He's making you into the image of Christ. In the crucible is where we give up our will. In the fires where we surrender. In the fires where we let go. In the fires where we say, not my will, but thine be done. We have to go from God, give me my inheritance, to make me what you want me to be. Amen. That's what the prodigal son did. Before he could get the robe, the ring, the shoes, he went in the beginning, Father, give me my inheritance. But when he came to the end of himself, God changed him. And now he came back and said, Father, make me. Will you make me a servant? The Father said, he's ready. Get the robe. Get the ring.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Amen.
So we got to go through something.
Yeah.
Don't think it's... Listen, my heart goes out for people. I've been through plenty of my own. But know this. God is with you. He'll never leave you or forsake you. He said, I'll be with you through the fire. The water will not overwhelm you. Job 23:10, Job said, when I'm tried, I'm going to come forth like gold.
Amen.
And so are you.
Amen.
So we have to be patient through the fire. Let patience have its perfect work. How many want to become perfect?
Hallelujah.
All right, now. Now this week, every time something comes up, you know, now no one may see it, but you can feel it.
Yeah.
You're about to. You're about to go, well, what the heck's going on over here? When that happens, just take a deep breath. Say, Lord, I'm going to let patience have its perfect. Now, what patience does is it kills us so that Christ can manifest. So in closing, how are we going to get there? One, we have to want to get there. We have to believe God's grace will get us there. We have to know that it's the end of the age, and we better become one with Jesus. I'm telling you, we better become one with Jesus so the world can see. That's what Jesus said. When we become one, fully mature, perfect in him, the world's going to believe. God's about ready to pour his spirit out in this old world one more time. It's going to be the great outpouring, greatest thing that's ever hit this planet. He's going to pour out on vessels that have been prepared, that are hungry and seeking after him. Lord, make us that. But so we got to understand. Number one, I surrender all. That's a starting place. Take up your cross. Follow me. Number two, we got to be people of the word. Read the word, believe the word, practice the word, pray the word. Number three, we have to be people of prayer. We have not because we ask not. But let's pray. And number four, we have to be patient. Be in the word, be in prayer, and then patient, steadfast. Don't give up, don't let up, don't back up, don't shut up until God shows up. Amen. That's how we're going to get there. by the grace of God. For it is God who works in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Thank you, Lord. Let's thank him. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray that you'll let us be, let us, those that are watching with us online, let us be part of the wheat, Lord, that grows up to full maturity. Lord, we want to be sons and daughters. Lord, we want to be washed in the water of your word. Lord, we ask you to anoint us with prayer. Give us a prayer anointing, Lord, like we've never had before. So come on, somebody agree with me. Lord, make us patient, Lord. Lord, as we go through those times, Lord, we start having that stuff rise up in us. Lord, let patience have its perfect work in us. Make us sons and daughters, oh God, that become one with you. Lord, have your way. We ask it in the name of Jesus. And Lord, for everything good, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And if you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
Let's give him praise.